Hello and welcome to News at 10. We're live on TV3 and 3FM 92.7 as well. We are streaming live on Facebook and 3news.com. I'm Stephen Enti. Let's start with the major news highlights for the day. Some food vendors in Accra have called on city authorities to fast-track the processes involved in the acquisition and renewal of health certificates. The issuance of health certificates is aimed at curbing the spread of communicable diseases from vendors to consumers. Right, let's start with the big one. A local governance expert and lawyer, Dr. Eric Odro-Osai, is suggesting the special prosecutor position should be made open for interested persons who qualify to apply. This, he believes, would make the selection process transparent and acceptable to all.
The presidential assent completes the legal requirement for the establishment of the Office of the Special Prosecutor following its passage by Parliament on November 14, 2017.
What people do not know is that acts do not implement themselves. It is institutions that implement acts. So the Office of Special Prosecutors Act would establish an office we call Office of the Special Prosecutor. That is an institution. Then you need an individual or group of individuals to manage that particular institution.
The specialized agency will investigate acts of corruption involving public officers, politically exposed persons, and persons in the private sector involved in the commission of corruption.
The Special Prosecutors Act, many believe, is a major leap in Ghana's fight against corruption, but experts warn its impact can only be determined by how truthful or professional the manager of that office is going to be.
This person, I'm expecting that that position should be advertised. Qualified people must apply. Competent and neutral interview panel must be constituted. The best person must be selected.
This, many believe, will make the process acceptable by all.
To go a very long way, but the issue is getting the right person or the right office who will be independent-minded. People who can tell the president or anybody in the face that this is what I think is right. That's the essential thing.
If the president only sits and appoints, definitely there will be this idea of coming to which hands somebody. But if there is a wider consultation and a person widely acceptable to all Ghanaians, definitely everybody will support.
The local governance expert and lawyer, Dr. Eric Odro-Osai, suggests the Special Prosecutor's Office be decentralized in order to make the required impact.
The prosecution should not only be at the High Court in Accra or in the regional capitals. They should be able to prosecute them at the Circuit Court. They should be able to prosecute them even at the Magistrate Court so that we can have the prosecution going on all over the country. By that, you would be fighting corruption holistically in all 216 MMDAs.
Now, an Associate Professor of Political Science at the University of Ghana, Professor Edward Van Yao-Jampo, is questioning how efficient the Special Prosecutor's Office would be, since he or she should be working on the advice of the Attorney General and Minister for Justice. He says the MPP has also failed to adhere to an initial proposal by the Institute of Economic Affairs, IEA, to set up an independent prosecutor instead of a special prosecutor. Let's get onto the telephone lines now and engage with him. Professor Jampo is on the line. Good evening, Prof, and thank you. Now, you say the special prosecutor should have been an independent prosecutor. Will the appointment of a truly independent person to that position make up for the flaws you have initially identified?
Yes. The idea was first mooted, I think, when the IE developed a paper called Democracy Consolidation Strategy Paper. That paper sought to identify the gaps in Ghana's democracy and propose recommendations for reform. Now, in that paper, it was seen, for instance, that one of the reasons why attorney generals have not over the years been able to prosecute corrupt officials, particularly amongst them or within their parties, it is humanly sometimes difficult to look at your own colleagues, people appointed by the same appointing authority as you. You look at them and then you prosecute them. And so the argument was that to be able to ensure that there is no witch hunting and that you deal with all corrupt officials both within and also outside the party, there was a need to separate the Ministry of Justice from the Attorney General's Department and to create an independent public prosecutor's office, an independent public prosecutor. Now, an independent public prosecutor is different from a special public prosecutor. Now, that was the recommendation, and it was argued that once that officer is independent from the control or insulated from the control of the Attorney General and also from the president, the executive arm of government, then the person can wield a double-edged sword that can be used to cut from within and then also outside the party as far as the fight against corruption is concerned. But unfortunately, the current arrangement, and in doing so, in giving meaning to that particular recommendation, then there was a need, the proposal was also made that then you have to amend the 1992 constitution because the power to prosecute, the prosecutorial powers of the state is solely in the bosom of the Attorney General, and that particular power is also entrenched in the 1992 constitution. If it's entrenched, it means difficult for you to take it away from the Attorney General. And so the proposal also called for an amendment of the Constitution so that you can take away the prosecutorial powers of the Attorney General and give it to the independent public prosecutor. Now, what has happened now, in my view, as I described in my earlier write-up, is that there is the proposal has been sort of watered down. What has happened now is a watered down form of the proposal in that the Attorney General would continue to wield his or her prosecutorial powers as entrenched in the Constitution. And again, the appointment of the special prosecutor is going to be, I think, the consent or on the recommendation or advice of the Attorney General. And so once this happens, the special prosecutor would be working in the shadows of the Attorney General. The Attorney General would have every right to direct what to prosecute and what not to be prosecuted, because the power to prosecute, in our country, is entrenched or it's in the bosom of the Attorney General, and you can't take away that power without the consent of the Attorney General. And so anybody exercising that power would have to do so sometimes. If you have a lenient person saying that, well, he may tell you that, well, go ahead and do whatever you want to do. But then if he wants to say that you can't prosecute a particular matter, he has every right to tell you, because by our Constitution, is the Attorney General that is reposed with the prosecutorial powers of the land.
But your earlier write-up, you actually referred to what the MPP has done as pussyfootis of the issues, suggesting that although you commended the government for speedily assenting to the special prosecutor's bill, you feel that it will not achieve the purpose for which it is aimed at. Or I can't get it, because I see we've been discussing the special prosecutor's office and an independent prosecution's office, which if it was done, which would have been through
the
constitutional amendment.
The problem that prevents an attorney general from prosecuting from within is going to be confronted by the special prosecutor is not going to be different because he's just going to be working in the shadows of the Attorney General. And if the Attorney General is unable to prosecute his own, then you don't, how possible, how is it that all of a sudden the special prosecutor, who is also going to be working in the shadows of the powers of the Attorney General, all of a sudden going to be able to prosecute from within? Attorney General was appointed by the president. The special prosecutor is also going to be appointed by the president. And this time, the Attorney General is even going to have a say in determining who becomes the special prosecutor. And so if the special prosecutor wants to deal with somebody within, and Attorney General feels that, look, he's our own person, and so don't do it, the Attorney General will have every right to tell him not to do it, because the prosecutorial power lies in the bosom of the Attorney General.
So,
and that is also entrenched.
So, Prof, your view is that the special prosecutor will be prosecuting the agenda of the government, technically, that they'll be hauling people they don't like before prosecuting and perhaps witch hunting them?
Well, the idea that has been bandied around is that the special prosecutor is expected to wield a double-edged sword to be able to look for corrupt officials from within and deal with them, and then also go outside your own party to deal with those who are found culpable of corruption. But I'm saying that the practical challenge is that the special prosecutor is not an independent officer. He does not operate. He hasn't got that autonomy and independence to operate outside the control of the Attorney General. And so if that is the case, then it is possible that the Attorney General can also intervene or can direct who to prosecute and who not to prosecute.
Right.
In that case, then work done, in my view, is not that much.
Right. Professor Jampo, we're grateful for your time. Thank you very much. Professor Jampo is an associate professor and director of the Center for European Studies, associate professor of political science at the University of Ghana. Now, the parish priest of the Christ the King Church, Father Campbell, has praised President Akufo-Addo for his policies geared towards improving living standards of Ghanaians, especially the poor. The Catholic priest, who led the entire council of his parish to pay a courtesy call on the president at the Flagstaff House, urged the president to ignore critics of his policies and remain focused.
Reverend Father Campbell said government decision to introduce free secondary education is a much welcome development, particularly by the church, which has been at the forefront of helping to get Ghanaian children educated. He urged the president to focus on the program and to address all implementation challenges that have arisen or may arise in the execution of the program.
We are well placed to assess the impact of such a transformative policy on most families in Ghana and also offer some comment. Please do not be disillusioned by your critics and the implementation difficulties you will encounter. Sir, you're on the right path and you do have our full support. Your decision and action on illegal mining or Galamsey menace, though a very difficult decision, you managed to implement it and deserve commendation.
President Akufo-Addo assured him of government resolve to improve the living conditions of the people and pledge support for the Wager Leprosarium.
The improvement in the quality of our landscape and in the environment and of a system that will therefore perpetuate itself in trying to improve and seeing to it that we don't return back to the bad old days in handling our environment. So once again, I appreciate the support that you have exhibited for it. It's part and parcel of the wider fight to sanitize our social relations, as issues of corruption or indiscipline in the manner in which people, it's all part and parcel of the same goal, that we can build a healthy nation with public services that provide exactly that public service to our people and whose focus are on what can be done to improve the conditions of life of the ordinary people of our country.
There's a Still News at 10, and you can hear us on 3FM 92.7 as well. And we're streaming live on our Facebook page. We'll be right back with more news. Welcome back. Now, the Ghana Water Company has shut down their Accra desalination plant that serves Teshinungwa and surrounding communities. But the Ghana Water Company is unable to tell when services will be restored. My colleague Parkwesi Asari earlier spoke with the senior manager of communications at Ghana Water Company on News 360.
We've received lots of complaints from residents that despite the desalination exercise, they're still having to taste salty water. Is that one of the reasons that it's precipitated the shutdown?
No, not at all. With water quality itself, the parameters within the water itself or the quality of the water should lie within a certain range. Now, we have been monitoring the range since the establishment of the desal plant, and all the parameters have always been within range. Okay, so people may have that perception that it is salty because they know that we abstract the sea for treatment. Okay, but in reality, it is not actually the case.
And have you received consents?
Well, we have received such consents. And like I said, there is no way we'll pump out water into the system that goes beyond the standards. Because we go by the World Health Organization standards and that of the Ghana Standards Authority's standards for drinking water. The water from the treatment plant lies within the range all the time. There hasn't been any time that any of the parameters have gone beyond the range. And the moment it goes beyond the range, it means that the water can't be pumped into the system.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So those complaints have come. We tried working at rectifying it, but it's more of a perception than reality.
Mr. Marty, earlier in your submission, you hinted of financial challenges. Has that got to do with your electricity bills?
It is also part of it. We have to pay capacity charge. We have to do other things as well. So it's having a toll on us. So all we need is to have a renegotiation of the contract.
Are you able to tell us how much of a burden it is to you in terms of real cost?
For now, I think we really need to draw more on the fact that Ghanaians need to bear with the situation so that we go into the renegotiation. Then we can resume the constant flow that we have for them.
So that brings me to my very next question. How long are we looking at? What's the waiting period?
It's a bit difficult for me to give timelines to it because it's a negotiation. And we have started this for some time now, and it's ongoing.
It's really unfair to say that we cannot say for certain when we're going to resume work. It's really unfair.
It's a negotiation. So it's going to be like, I want this, I can provide this. So until we all get to a compromise, it becomes very difficult for us to
end. It means they can wait, it's possible to resume sometime next year?
No, we hope it to be soon.
How soon?
That is the difficulty.
Why is it a difficulty?
It's difficult because I don't know when we are going to get to a compromise.
This is water we are talking about.
It's very essential, and that is why we've made alternative arrangements. So we'll make sure that the people living in the area will have...
And how much is this alternative arrangement going to cost you?
No, it's the same supply. I mean, we've only have to ration. So we'll deprive certain areas on a number of days so that we can supply Teshin.
And the encroachers along the rail lines behind the Nyaho Clinic and its environs at Airport West in Accra have vowed not to vacate the slum, defying government's orders. They have now moved from erecting makeshift structures to building permanent ones along the rail lines.
Huge sums of money have been allocated in the 2018 budget for rail development. And what we can anticipate in the near future is that there is going to be a lot of disasters along rail lines because now people are moving from the normal squatters construction into massive buildings just along the rail lines. It can be disastrous for the future.
Some 120 meters from former President Kufuor's residence and behind the Nyaho Clinic in the Airport West area lie the rail lines linking Tematu in Sawim. Some traders and other businesses are briskly booming around the rail line. This has resulted in some of them encroaching the lines, posing danger to their lives. Apart from the area housing some prominent figures in the country, the Sudan and Brazilian embassies are close by. The squatters seem adamant on this development despite government's commitment to develop the rail lines. The encroachment, which started slowly some 7 years ago, is gradually becoming a haven for miscreants. The unperturbed squatters alluded that they were forced to put up their structures because other state officers had begun building around the area.
When a council of state member, you see, a council of state member like Asuma Banda, like Asuma Banda, this is war. Just about 10 feet away from the railway line. And look at this. This is Ibrahim Mahama. Just about 8 feet away from the railway line. They are the elders. They know the law. Watch it. When they do it, then the poor people too, they get a chance to push their little kiosks into the corners and have a good, they must breathe. They must live. They all vote equally. One vote, one man.
The disgruntled encroachers have threatened to resist any attempt by state authorities to eject them.
Why is it being selective justice you do it? Why wouldn't you sack? They say they are the people and they must move first. Before the poor will move. Otherwise, Yentia said that.
Currently, government has earmarked 327 million cedis in the 2018 budget to revive rail transportation in the country.
And all is set for the special parliamentary sitting on Friday. Information from the Public Affairs Directorate of Parliament indicates there being a positive response from all members to be present for the sitting.
Parliament has been recalled from recess for a special sitting on Friday following a motion by the minority. Head of the Public Affairs Directorate, Kate Addo, said it is going to be a normal sitting following the normal parliamentary proceedings.
All is set for the House to sit on Friday. You see the usual things that happen, the opening prayer, and then the motion proceedings will be corrected. Then the agenda for the day will be dealt with. Don't forget that in the last parliament, which is the sixth parliament, we had a similar situation when the minority then, which is now the majority, you know, requested for a sitting of the House. So we have precedence, you know, to base Friday's activities on.
The minority's motion was earlier described as unnecessary by the majority leader, but the speaker admitted it anyway, calling for the special sitting. Some experts, however, anticipate a dismissal of the motion by the speaker during the sitting based on the fact that the issue is not of urgent national importance, as claimed by the minority.
Depending on which side of the political divide you are on, you may hold a particular view. But ultimately, what happens is that our democracy is improving. I've also heard talk about the fact that it may cost the nation some money. Yes, democracy is expensive, but ultimately it's cheaper when you compare it to the absence of democracy.
The special sitting is scheduled for 10 a.m. Friday, January 5.
And that's it for News at 10. Thank you very much for staying with us. I'm Stephen Antti. On behalf of the crew, good night. There is more news at 3news.com.